Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Dennis Prager Show. Michael Walsh, you wrote a very powerful piece in American Greatness about California. I was reading, I spent a good chunk of the first hour reading the front page of the New York Times piece to my listeners about how California is basically declared war on the Trump administration and on the, you know, that part of America. The irony is you and the New York Times agree. And I agree. Yes. I agree, too. That's right. That's what it is. You call it Fort Sumter. Go ahead.
Well, I think it's what we're looking at here is the same issue. You know, human beings change, but human nature never changes. And history doesn't change much either. We keep recycling the same arguments. And this one has to do with the state's rights to nullify federal law. And that's been a back-and-forth swing in the United States since the founding of the country, obviously. And the Ninth and Tenth Amendments are the keystones of this. So depending on whose sauce for goose or gander it is, the states and the feds take alternating positions sometimes on this. But right now, California has decided that it's a sanctuary state, which means it's effectively a lawless state. And it's now acting in open defiance of federal immigration matters. You would have thought, Dennis, that they had settled this with the Arizona issue, where the feds came in and said Arizona cannot make its own immigration standards, and we will do, you know, what the feds are going to do. That was under the Obama administration. I think that was called SB 1070 or something like that. So the left cheered that then, but now they're cheering California's defiance of the federal immigration statutes, and I don't think this is going to end well for California. That's my larger point.
Well, and go ahead. Why not?
Well, because I think they'll lose. I think that we settled this in 1865 the hard way. And I've just come off reading Grant's memoirs, which, by the way, I recommend to every American.
Those are considered to be the finest presidential writings.
They're wonderful. It's almost entirely about his Civil War experiences. So I read
Ronald White's biography of Grant, and I found the man so impressive.
Well, I read that biography, too, and I must say it rearranged my position on Grant. Not that it needed much rearranging, but this notion that Grant was an incompetent,
a big drunk, yeah, exactly,
boob and a
hack.
And
yep.
This is the left's revenge on having lost the Civil War. Because let's face it, Dennis, the Civil War was Republicans versus Democrats.
Yeah.
It's that simple.
How many seniors at Harvard would know that?
None, I would guess.
Right. Okay. Just curious.
I mean,
anyway, I want to know. Wait, I want to go back because you actually gave me an optimistic thought, which I don't want to let go. That California may lose in this battle. Why do you feel that?
Well, I don't think the federal government can allow states to decide which federal laws they're going to choose to accept or reject. As you know, some states' attorney generals have decided to open lawfare against the Trump administration. New York State, which is a rock's throw away from me here, Eric Schneiderman has constantly been involved in suing the administration on this, that, or the other thing. And, of course, Jerry Brown, is just as anti-Trump as can be. And P.S., by the way, I made this point in the piece that America...
All right, don't forget your P.S. We'll be back in a moment. What I really want to discuss is all the bassoon concertos by Vivaldi, but I don't want to lose my audience. Michael Walsh is a big classical music aficionado and expert, so it's unbelievably tempting, my friend, since that is a deep love of mine as well. However, we return to the ugly world of politics. Nevertheless, you have a take on the California, essentially, civil war with the United States, and I don't know why that is not a fair term, but tell me why you don't think it's going to, this is what we were talking about, why you think it will not end well for California.
Right. Well, I wrote this piece in the new website, relatively new, called the American
Greatness. Which, let me plug, by the way, folks, it is superb. Period. End of issue. It is one of my 10 favorite websites in the world.
Oh, that's very kind of you. I'm in there every Thursday, writing about cultural Marxism and, you know, sort of the larger crisis that we're all facing. So thank you for the plug, Dennis. What I wrote was Sacramento fires on Fort Sumter, which I think is very apt because it's precisely what they've done. And I was going to observe before the break that I went to California in 1954 as a four-year-old boy, almost five, and growing up there, Pat Brown was my governor for much of the time I was in California, and then I left, and I came back in 1977 to San Francisco, and Jerry Brown was my governor, and then I left, and I came back to work in Hollywood around the beginning of the 2000s, and now Jerry Brown's my governor again. You're looking at a kind of familial oligarchy in California. It's being run almost like a caudillo system, you know, from Latin America, where one family has dominated the politics now for more than a half a century. And this is not good. It's not good for democracy. It's not good for California. It's not good for the Brown family. It shows you the negative value of a Jesuit education now, since Jerry was studying for the priesthood at one point until, as I point out in the article, he realized it would cramp his style trying to date Linda Ronstadt. So he didn't study for the priesthood anymore.
Well, may I say Catholic priesthood's loss is our loss. I should say Catholic priesthood's gain is our loss.
Yeah, well, the point is that I think that the California is barking up the wrong tree. I think if you read Grant's memoirs and you see how clearly he understood the stakes, he always refers to it as the War of Rebellion. He always refers to it as the rebels. He grants the Confederacy zero legitimacy. He is amused when the Democrat Party runs the most failed general on the Union side, George McClellan, as a copperhead peace Democrat to sue for peace. And he understood that Lincoln was in great danger of losing that 1864 election. But luckily, Gettysburg came along, Vicksburg came along, and then, of course, Atlanta came along. And this really saved the Union in Grant's
The administration has threatened to arrest California officials. Should they?
Yes. Why not?
I'm just asking.
Yeah.
Of course they should be. But what would happen then? Wouldn't there be? I think there would then be violence in the streets in the state.
Well, you think all the people west of the 405 are suddenly going to rise up? The people that vote for Democrats in California? If you look at California, it's a giant red state with two sort of blue colonies along the coast. Now, granted that it has the majority of the voters in those two colonies, and it's possible there'd be violence. I don't know. But, I mean, at what point then is...
No, it doesn't matter. No, I agree with you. What about drug laws? What about pot? The federal laws are in conflict with Colorado and California.
Well, California has two senators. The last time I looked, can't they sponsor change in the legislation at the federal level? I mean, is there some way to do it other than saying, no, I refuse to accept your authority here? The issue isn't the laws. The issue is who's to be boss, who's to be master, as Humpty Dumpty famously said in Alice in Wonderland. You know, which one is to be master, me or you? So is it California or is it the federal government? Let's get this out in the open. Let's have the conversation. They always want to have a conversation. Let's have a conversation.
That's right. This is what we're living through now. I mentioned, by the way, to my listeners, and I am a California resident, that they periodically, the left here, talks about seceding from the Union. And I say all the time, I would vote for it. I would then move, but... But I would vote for it. California is having a toxic impact on the country because of its staggering number of citizens, or at least of voters, and the values that it stands for are antithetical to normative American values. So I think that if California left, first of all, it would be a permanent Republican majority.
Yes, that's true. They'd lose 50-some electors.
Yes, that would be it.
And by the way, this Sanctuary State Act is something, it's called something like the California Values Act.
Yes, I know, which is true. I agree with it.
Actually, it is.
That's a very fair, yes, it's a fair name for what they're doing.
Yes, but I think, I hope you agree with me, I think the federal government has to take this in hand because this challenge, We went through this with James A. Buchanan when he was president. And in the run-up to 1860, in the election of 1860, the authority of the federal government was being challenged by multiple Democrat-dominated southern states. It's no different today, except that the Democrats have moved elsewhere.
Exactly.